This is a study that a grad student that I worked with did about 5 years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. And I presented this at the National Poultry Waste Management Symposium. I haven't presented it to the Waste to Worth group yet, so I thought this would be fitting to kind of resurrect this this study and kind of give you an update. At the time, we were getting questions about E. coli hitting waterways in Oklahoma and Arkansas and the sources of them, and they always seem to be pointed at litter applications. So that was kind of the basis for forming this. And so you think about the types of litter bacteria. Of course, you've got your good microbes, your pathogenic. Salmonella, Campylobacter being two predominant ones that we could find. Your indicator organisms, which we talked about today. E. coli being a common one. I think it's good, I mean, just to refresh us and remind the public that E. coli is commonly found in nature. It's in warm-blooded animals. The media really likes to take off with E. coli, and fingers start pointing real quickly. So this is kind of my extension spiel, and I tell this to producers as well, that, you know, some can be pathogenic, and then we have some that are beneficial microorganisms as well. The sources, you're talking 0157H7, cattle is a predominant source. We can see it in other wildlife. And, you know, the question remains, how long does it remain in feces, soil, and water, with different research supporting different theories on that. Transmission, of course, direct deposits from livestock. Petting zoos, when I was in North Carolina, we had an issue with kids going to a petting zoo and then going and eating cotton candy, and we had an outbreak there, so we kind of see hand sanitizer more frequently now at those. Kids in diapers and pools, that makes me get out of the water. So, but there's multiple sources out there. It may take 3 or 4 days before we start to see symptoms. We may not have symptoms, or it could be mild diarrhea. If it gets more serious, we're looking at hemorrhagic colitis and hemolytic uremic syndrome. If that gets even worse, you can go into kidney failure, death. So that's kind of the background of why we had these questions on poultry litter and land application. So that's what we set out to answer. We conducted a small field study at our research station, and the idea was to investigate concentrations transported by surface runoff after we land apply poultry litter. This was our field. We had a mixture of grasses. You could see some clover there, some fescue, Bermuda grass. And this was a wet spring, so it was kind of hard to get into this field, but I'm okay with that. We got in a little bit later, but at the time, I mean, that's real world, guys. That's what the producers are doing. They're waiting until they can get into a field. So we were applying litter at the same time the producers were. There's kind of an intermittent channel right here going through this field. And our plots were set up here with a downslope facing that intermittent channel. No cattle on this field for over a year. No litter application for well over a year. And this is one of our research stations. Our buildings here face, this is north. Here's our field. These are our 14 plots that we set up. And here's our intermittent channel that kind of runs through the field. And then we had your typical rainfall simulator set up there. We had 14 plots. Our treatment was 2.2 tons per acre of broiler litter. I went and got that the day of the trial. It came from a full house clean out. What else? That was about a year old litter. We had two control plots where we did not apply litter, and we also wanted to apply some litter in plots or areas outside of the 2 meter by 2 meter plot to not be exposed to rainfall, so we set that up as well. We subjected it to artificial rainfall at 2 year storm event, which is 45 minutes at 2.3 inches per hour. and then a 5-year storm event, which was 30 minutes at 3 inches per hour. And this is kind of what it looked like as far as we applied our poultry litter. And then at 0 hours, we came in and had a rainfall event. So that simulates, so basically we go in and apply rainfall at 0 hours. So that's like if you go out on the field and apply the litter, and as you're driving off the field, a rain event occurs. Once we applied rainfall, we discarded those plots, we're done with them. And then we applied rainfall at a 24-hour period, and we had a lot of sunshine that week, so we extended it out to 120 hours, which would be 5 days. So we were comfortable looking at a 5-day window here. We're kind of playing with Mother Nature, because had it rained, it would have messed up our simulated rainfall events. So this study, the window is 5 days. And then we measured E. coli populations off of those plots. And this was the rainfall simulator. Our flume was set up in a trench that was dug there, down in slope, and we basically collected water in that every 2 minutes, and then immediately analyzed it for E. coli populations. Again, I don't normally see vegetation this high when we're applying litter, but this was real world for us. Rain gauge in there to check our storm event. How do you like this vegetative buffer? It's non-existent. So this is as if we applied litter up to, a waterway essentially. But we're collecting it right there in that flume. Here we're looking at a hydrograph showing our 2-year event and our 5-year event. This is the 45-minute versus 30-minute, 2.3 inches per hour, 3 inches per hour, a volume of 1.72 inches, volume of 1.5 inches. And essentially, we reached our peak runoff sooner on the heavier 5-year event. So that's kind of what we expected to see on the different plots. So we were successful with our rainfall simulators. And now getting into the raw data. I would focus on this area. This is the average event mean concentrations. These are our control plots, which were surprisingly higher than what we were expecting. We start to see a bit of an increase at the 0 hour compared to our control plot, but then we start to see a decline from 0 hour to 24 hour and 5 days. And we have significant differences in the 0 hour compared to the 24 hour and 120 hour. We didn't see significant differences in our control plots, but we were close. Okay, this is a 95% confidence limit. Had I known the E. coli populations were going to be this high in our control plots, I would have increased our number of control plots. So that's hindsight for us. I didn't expect to see populations that high. This is a little easier way to view the data. If I don't assign significance to the control, but I compare these, I can see that we saw a significant drop at 24 hours, a little bit of a bump here at 5 days. Speculation on that could be maybe that litter fell to the bottom and was covered from UV light because we had such high vegetation there. But that's pure speculation. I would have liked to have taken this experiment out longer to see how this would potentially level off. My thoughts are that it would level off, but I'd be interested to hear others in the room that might have experience here. If I put this on a 90% confidence limit, then another way to look at this is we're bringing the populations back down to the natural background levels within 24 hours with a slight bump here. So the question is, and what I kind of point out to legislators and policymakers and producers is that don't get this idea that we're going to bring the E. coli populations back down to here and consider the background populations that we're seeing there. And they do provide, substantial loads to waterways, potentially. From just the natural background populations in the soil. We saw a similar trend in E. coli levels that were placed outside of the plot, so that was, I thought, good. They matched our rainfall simulated plots. So essentially what we found is that the E. coli decreased at 24 hours and 5 days compared to that 0 hour period. We always detected E. coli in our control plots. And, you know, we suspect it's small mammals, rodents, birds, et cetera. I could see some mouse trails going through those plots. But, I mean, livestock had not been on this for over a year. I didn't see any visible cow pies or anything. So, in conclusion, the litter applications may contribute to runoff when rainfall events occur shortly after manure application. So if I'm driving off a field and a rainstorm hits, then I would suspect, and of course depending on the vegetative buffer distance, but I would suspect that we could see some contributions from land application of manure or poultry litter. But there's other sources out there, and they can serve as a significant component of that total E. coli load. And as the time increases after land application, those background populations may be a pretty significant source of that total E. coli that's getting into the streams. And that's kind of the take-home message, is what we're seeing out there is background. And if we give it days, weeks, we may be getting more contribution from that natural background population. So I told you that would be short. This is where I'm at. This is Eastern Oklahoma, if you've never been there. And I didn't know Eastern Oklahoma looked like that until I moved here. But I was expecting to move to prairie land. But that's the Illinois River. That's the one that has made the news over poultry litter lawsuits and regulations in the past. But it's pretty clean and pristine when I've seen it and floated it. And we're seeing concentrations of phosphorus go down. So, but anyway, that's what we're looking to protect in my neck of the woods. So I welcome feedback, comments, questions. Thanks. Hey, Chris.
Yes, ma'am.
Thanks for that, Josh. And I guess, you know, when I look at that, and even when you look at the differences in your log numbers, even though those are statistically significant, to me that's not biological. You know, and I think that's always the message that I try to take home when I'm dealing with policyholders or I'm dealing with the public. Things can be mathematically significant, but not something biologically significant. And really what you saw there was that there wasn't any really biological change.
I wish I could have taken that out further. I'm thinking it would have leveled off to the background populations. And that little spike that we saw at 5 days didn't really bother me. The grad student wrote a little bit about it and kind of went into detail about vegetative cover and all this, or buffering and soil moisture that was already there, but to me it didn't really bother me too much. I'd love to see more work done on this. I'd like to see some more source tracking, you know, and I'd like to see this taken out for a longer period of time. But this is just a small field study.
One of the things I've found repeatedly and repeatedly, even though I've seen it published, poultry litter and E. coli, is that there's almost no E. coli in any poultry litter that I've ever tested. Yeah. It stuns me how little E. coli there is in poultry litter. It's like poultry litter is teeming with bacteria, but because it's a very competitive environment, actually, there's really isn't a lot of E. coli in it. So actually, I think, you know, and there is a lot in the background. The question I have is, what method did you use to detect the
MPN, IDEX?
Yeah, sometimes I wonder if the IDEX works like the soil versus water where it was meant to be. Everything we do in ag, you know, or I guess soil maybe, but, you know, just so much hard, it's so hard to get it to work in your systems. But I find there's a lot of background E. coli as well.
Yeah.
It's just there.
Yeah. I think it's a good message to get out there. Sir, Carl, did you have a question?
You said from a biological perspective, you didn't see any significance. You were saying from the control level, the bulk that you saw with the application was from a biological, no difference.
No, yeah, I mean, in a lot of these things, I mean, you can get a half log difference that's statistically significant, but it's absolutely meaningless. FIFRA registration for a sanitizer or disinfectant, for example, you need to see 4 to 5 logs difference for it to be something biologically meaningful. But a log, a half log,
I want to clarify that, because the general discussion we have, Melanie, it's, I'm getting more and more concerned that we can generate numbers.
That's right, but if we don't generate...
And we can generate statistical difference, but are we understanding and interpreting those numbers and correctly conveying and educating on what those numbers mean?
I would say no. And I'm not a microbiologist, you know, and my time that I did microbiology, you know, we were still in the benchtop microbiology mode, which we're not now. And now, if you have an incubator and a PCR, it's so much easier now to generate these numbers. But we used to look at this, and you couldn't publish on this. And then people would say, that's not biologically significant. You know, particularly if you're looking at intervention efficacies. Now, if it's statistical, everybody talks about it as if it means something. And that's troubling for me as a clinical practitioner.
There's also differences in how microbiologists versus engineers interpret the data.
Right.
As far as
statisticians.
How many logs do you need? And for them, 90% reduction, because that's nothing biologically. So it's different disciplines in that.
Ask yourself if you would eat 10 to the 8th campy or 10 to the 7th campy. Neither one. So that's a 90% change. Okay, thanks a lot to everyone for attending the session today.